Bringing Hysteria to the UK was always an ambition once we'd done it in Vegas. You know, that's what happened 5 years ago when AEG contacted our management and said, we want to put Def Leppard in Las Vegas doing the Hysteria album. And we went, oh, interesting concept. And of course, as we were, you know, rehearsing this and then we get into doing the residency, we'd talk and say, God, it'd be great to be able to do this in the UK.
Can you bump in on the side here for me, please? Good.
I was a Def Leppard fan for many years before being in the band, and very much looking forward to Hysteria, as indeed were many people. You know, after Rick's accident and the record taking so many years, there was a lot of anticipation, and being the follow-up to Pyromania, which in itself was a landmark record. It was one of the first CDs that I bought, and when I started listening to it on CD, particularly in headphones, and then I started realizing, oh, there's so much more going on than you realize at first. It's just hit song after hit song after hit song. It's just heavy with hooks.
I think one of the great things about Hysteria, certainly from my point of view, is just the sound that we created back then was pretty groundbreaking. It had never really been done before. And to do it in the genre of hard rock, I just think it became a groundbreaking album.
It crossed so many boundaries. It wasn't just a rock record anymore. I think melodically, the songs just reach everybody. Young, old, you name it. I think it's just the fact that they're really well-written songs and probably one of the best recorded albums, thanks to Mutt Lange, in history. I think he really went all out to make sure that it just had longevity.
It's our biggest, it's our best album. It kind of defines who we are. Pyromania influenced loads of rock bands. It was great, it was different. Hysteria took it up a few notches. Fair play to Mutt Lange, because that's what he had in mind, was doing something. He said, let's not make a clone of Pyromania. Everyone else has done that. Let's do something else. Different influences: Run DMC, The Police, Prince, Billy Idol. But he was going, we have a level of excellence we've got to meet, and we've got to be talking about this in 20 years. He actually said that to someone once. It was like, they said, why are you spending so much time on this record? And he said, so you're talking about it in 20 years. And here we are 31 years later.
Watch the fingers.
We were in the throes of putting the new record together. The year after that, we were making the new album. The year after that, we were promoting it. So it's taken this long for it to become a reality in the UK, but it's always been, not even on the back burner, it's always been in our minds to bring it here, because once we'd done it in the States, we knew we had to come back home with it at some stage.
Relearning Hysteria, or some of the B-side songs, as it were a little tricky, just challenging.
And it's one thing relearning those songs, but the other songs, the other seven, we've played regularly. So it's getting them to the standard of the others. That was the hard part.
There's no such thing as an easy Def Leppard song. Obviously, we had to rehearse the songs that we don't play very often, you know, Don't Shoot Shotgun, Run Riot, Excitable, Love and Affection, Gods of War. They're songs that don't regularly feature in a Def Leppard show. Many of the others do, like Sugar and Armageddon and Hysteria itself.
What's been really hard is the three easiest sounding songs, like Don't Shoot Shotgun, Run Riot and Excitable. And them three, they're so demanding vocally. There's so much vocal going on and just doesn't let up.
But in, you know, true Def Leppard fashion, you know, we just kept at it, and I think we came up with live versions that are really good, true representation of the studio versions of the songs.
This time round, I've always likened it to, it's more of a show than a gig, if you can see the difference. It's like, this is more theatre, and it's more of a musical, because we are replicating an actual entity. We're not just playing a collection of songs. And to me, that's probably been the most rewarding, demanding and refreshing all at the same time part of doing it. It was like, you're in a slightly different mind space, because we're actually slaves to this big musical epic piece, you know. And I kind of like that in a way.
It's always wonderful to play live. That's always the fun part. This tour, the energy has been great around the shows, not just because of where the band is at and the excitement that's around the band right now, but because our audience has become multi-generational. The youthful energy that's in a Def Leppard show in 2018 is very palpable to us. When there's an energy from the audience, that just kind of takes us further, and that's really something that we've always been feeding off, and it's exceptional this year.
We'll drop that in and we'll start, we'll do it.
Yeah. You want the crown down, right?
Yes, I think we do. There should be crown down.
Heads up!
Mind you back, ladies and gentlemen, mind you back.
When we were young whippersnappers wanting to be in a band, or we'd just formed the band, it wasn't like, yeah, the City Hall was like a something to aim at, but we'd been reading for years about Madison Square Gardens or Wembley, Empire Pool, as it was called at the time, or the LA Forum and stuff like that. And these were the iconic venues that you wanted to play in, but it's really become like a buzzword ever since an evening with Led Zeppelin. It wasn't really Led Zeppelin, but the 2007 gig that was Robert, Jimmy and John Paul Jones with Jason, which I was at, actually.
I must say, I've never been to the O2 before today. I've never even set foot in the place, never seen a gig here, knew very little about it, other than that it was bloody huge.
We're not stood still like the Eagles either, so the last thing you need is somebody banging their head.
He won't come. He's on a long length, so he's getting kind of
right.
Yeah. He's not looking.
Oh, it's no problem if he comes on the stage, as long as it's 10, 12 feet.
But he won't go.
Feet.
Otherwise, the only ones that really affect is the three-man Rick. But
that's not what the only. That's my only issue. I come down there, and as long as that yellow line, tape is there, and I don't trip over that little lumpy bit.
Please don't do that.
That's my only. Well, it's slow motion. It'll look awesome.
It would.
What we're doing, I refer to you to the. John's going to be over at the back here on certain songs, with your permission. I can write out Animal, Sugar, Don't Shoot, etc. I want him to come round the back.
Basically, getting that shot that way. And he'll just walk all the way back. He won't stay at any point, otherwise, if you move back.
Yeah, because I'm fairness, I'm looking out that way so much, I don't really know what the other three are doing when I'm at.
Yeah.
And I know that they don't hog their mics. On Animal, Phil will go from that side to this, but mostly along the front, so the back should be clear.
Yeah, so what's safe for as well is that I've marked certain tracks down. Yeah. So I want John to come on stage.
Okay.
With this. I mean, I'd say don't play to it, because I find it a little bit hammy.
Okay.
I want you to play that way to your crowd. Totally.
I mean, look, there might be towards the end of the set where I can go.
You don't have
to use it.
Oh, love it. I saw you guys in Belfast. The crowd really, they start clapping back. That shot from back here is going to be awesome.
I know you're going somewhere.
Yeah.
But I'm generally pretty good at watching.
Yeah, I mean, it's gone on the day when it was cables and shit.
Well, I'm down there.
No. That's awesome.
Yeah. Remember, so when
we naturally choreograph. Yeah. There's certain things that we do all the time because it works.
Yeah.
Me and Phil do this shoulder, Keith. You know, Mick and Keith thing on shotgun.
So,
cool. Is that it?
I mean, he'll keep your eye out for you guys.
Yeah, that's
great. If I think people are going to move, he'll just come back out the way.
The O2 here in London has become iconic. So I've been here before, I know how iconic this place is, and it's just something you have to aim for. And it's always nice to go to Wembley because it's got the same kind of reputation, but this is a new venue for Def Leppard. We have never played here before. So we wanted to do something special. It sold an astonishing amount of tickets, so we made a snap decision about 3 weeks ago that we should film it. And lucky for us, there was somebody available to do it. So you know, it's going to be a special night that will always be remembered for that reason. It won't just be another gig. It'll be a gig that we've filmed and it will eventually come out.
It's probably going to be the biggest indoor gig we've ever done, which is great. You know, it's just another little box that you tick off. I think there's going to be up towards about 18,000 people in there. So I think that's probably bigger than the Earl's Court shows that we did back in the 90s. It's a great place to do the gig, and you know, it's a great place to film it.
It's great to, you know, have another notch on your belt type thing. The Budokan, you know, in Japan, and Madison Square Garden, and some of these stadiums we've just done, they're kind of bucket list things. So this is really, we've never played here, and I've only ever been here once. I saw Rihanna here a few years ago, but it's awesome to be able to bring that production, because it's very theatrical, and that's what the great thing about taking this on the road as opposed to just doing a tour. It looks expensive, it is expensive, and it's just classic. It's just like a theatrical masterpiece, and we get to play the songs, you know, as they are on the album. It's just, it's a joy.